Sky Kurtz, founder and CEO of Pure Harvest, welcome to Bloomberg. The food security minister, Mariam Al-Mahari, said to me, nobody knew who I was until COVID arrived. How close did the two of you become, and how big has your business become since COVID?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. And Her Excellency Mariam, we've become close over the years. Her advocacy of the food security file advanced our sector significantly. So we're grateful for the work she's done. And of course, she's ascended to a bigger role now. COVID was a double-edged sword. Obviously, it was very hard to live through for everybody and created great difficulty in the business. On the other hand, it was a powerful awareness event globally for food security and the insecurity of the value chains that supply food, especially fresh food. You know, things like what we produce that are perishable in max 10 to 14 days. So the business has grown considerably. We're now in UAE, Saudi, building in Kuwait, building in Singapore, and we're producing a broad variety of crops, not just tomatoes, which we used to produce. It's melons and strawberries and peppers, and we're doing a multitude of crops.
Well, I was going to say, you very kindly brought us in. I mean, some of these products here are on the tomato side. What is your biggest product?
Well, the cherry on the vine and, of course, just round tomatoes are the most popular. But this is a yum. It's a quite a unique product. It's the highest antioxidant in tomato, so it has special properties, but it's also a specialty product.
Are you cleaner than organic?
Yes, we are. So fundamentally, we don't use pesticides. We would use a targeted soft chemical intervention if we had to. But day-to-day, beneficial insects and the technology protect our crop.
When I look at the numbers for you, 460 people, 22 hectares of land, expanding into Kuwait and beyond, how would you describe how food security has evolved in terms of the UAE and Saudi?
Well, so I think the region has always had a focus on feeding its people and food security. There were organizations and efforts long before COVID, long before Her Excellency Mariam's federal appointment as a food security minister. However, I think it has evolved in that they're taking a multi-pronged strategy. And in certain crops, like if you think of the calorie pyramid, in certain staple crops that have longer shelf life, they're sourcing strategically and they're creating strategic reserves and storage. In other crops, like fresh produce, there's an effort to enable and support investment in the sector. And I think that more could be done, but it's a key focus to enable this to happen. And so they have a multi-pronged approach. And I would say generally, though, the narrative on food security and on investment in food has boomed. Also, even in Saudi, where the Ag Development Fund is deploying billions in supporting food companies and agriculture businesses to build. And of course, we're building there as well.
You want to build out in Saudi, you want to build out further. Are you finding it easy to raise capital? Are you seeing more government support for your business? Or is it from the private sector? Who's going to drive the growth for you?
Well, it's a bit of a challenge. I would say capital is actually, to some extent, drying up in our sector because there was a bit of irrational exuberance in our sector. There were a lot of people confused these new technologies for food production as a panacea for needs on food and an infinitely scalable technology. But admittedly, in the end, this is food infrastructure, right? We're taking bare earth building, large technology, glass, steel, infrastructure, power systems. And so that scalability wasn't there. And you've seen some rationalization in the sector, high profile bankruptcies like AppHarvest AeroFarms, a vertical farming company that also has a presence in the region.
Does that give you a greater market share? I mean, other people's tough times and demise surely emboldens your position in the market.
Well, I think like many sectors, it forces consolidation and makes possible scale. But what I will say, though, it scares away capital. There's a bit of a baby with the bathwater effect. And what I would say in this sector generally, globally, it's out of favor now. But when you asked about governments and all, there are some support or development finance efforts supporting the sector. But admittedly, that's a key area where more is needed. In the end, we're energy, so sunlight and capital are what make possible this outcome. So cost of capital is a critical enabler for our business.
So you are both vertical farms and greenhouses. That's where we are at the moment. And it's been a bit of a slog to get to this stage. Cast your mind forward. What will the greenhouse of the future look like?
I think it'll be actually a portfolio of technologies. So this is a sector called Controlled Environment Ag, and there are many different tools, all the way from, on one end, an AI-powered, fully indoor, automated lighting, or artificial lighting, automated high-tech vertical farm in, say, Manhattan, all the way to kind of a field farm with a net that uses automated drip irrigation or something, some level of technology adoption. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a portfolio of solutions needed. And for example, here in a place with extreme climate, what we're building, which is very high tech, it's high investment, but low OpEx. And we're able to grow year round, extremely high quality, safe and sustainable, low water intensity product. And that's needed. But say in a market like Morocco or Egypt or Malaysia, you need a different level of technology. So it's really about the right level of investment and technology. But really the future of farming, I believe, is like we are, right? It's in a controlled environment. Climate change is wreaking havoc on every sector, but particularly, you know, crops, right, that are ultimately subject to weather events, subject to droughts. And this is a major problem. So the fragility of our supply chains have been exposed by events like COVID, the Russia-Ukraine crisis, and what that did to fertilizers, et cetera. But admittedly, I think more needs to be done, and the investment needs to accelerate now before we wait for food supply shocks. And by then, it takes years to build this infrastructure. I mentioned this to you, so I think it's an important time to be investing.
When you look, you mentioned the use of water, you've mentioned the fertilizers, et cetera. I just want to hone in on the sustainability aspect and the water usage. Greenhouses don't have the best of reputation. I know the world has evolved. Just how sustainable is your water usage? What's your pedigree in water?
Well, so water is an interesting one. People talk about absolute water consumption, not water consumption per kilogram. So we are dramatically better than, say, a field farm. We're over 30 times more efficient, meaning total liters of water consumed per kilo of production. Than a low-tech incumbent seasonal producer, mm-hmm. We're about 7 to 10 times more efficient. So 10 times the production per unit of water. So it's a step change in resource efficiency. But that's true also in Australia or Canada or America, where controlled environment ag of different levels has been adopted. People need to be careful to make sure that they're quoting the right statistic. Controlled environment accelerates the production and limits the evapotranspiration of the plant. That allows for more water-efficient production. It's an important step about water conservation.
We've already had a little bit of a food tasting of these tomatoes by the staff. How much more expensive is your product relative to what I can buy? Are we prepared? Are we prepared to pay for this kind of quality and this kind of product?
Well, in this market, we're heavily import dependent. So we created a new category when we entered the market, which was what we call premium local. We're above the seasonal, lower quality, you know, field or low tech produced tomato, for instance.
Mm-hmm. But we're the lowly tomato.
Yeah, but we're a significant discount to the air freighted imports that would come from, say, Europe or Morocco or Tunisia, because we don't have the air freight, right? So we're a new category. And so typically we'd be anywhere from 20 to 60% cheaper than that import, but at 20 to 40% premium to the local seasonal production. So I believe many people are prepared to pay for that, but I will say some people cannot. So one of our goals at Pure Harvest, we're actually going down market. We started our technology at the highest end of the market. We're now developing what we call the LCTA, the lowest cost but technically acceptable farm. And the goal is to build the right level of technology so that we can access and serve all people, not just those that shop at premium modern retailers around the world.